messieurs, bonjour et bienvenue au Water Bar de Colette. Je présente Young Guru, mythique ingénieur du son pour Jay-Z, Kanye West, T.I., Drake, qui est venu pour en ce moment, qui est aussi DJ de la tournée Watch the Throne.
So, you were talking about your top three producers being Pete Rock, Primo, and Dilla. Dilla, number one.
Hip-hop producers.
It's funny because you are, we're going to do a little jump and then come back to it, but you are today like the gatekeeper of hip-hop, commercial hip-hop, as we're going to see in a few hours today. How is that a problem for you when you work with Jay-Z, or does it come from you, the influence, that sometimes you go, okay, he's doing backpacking rap right
now?
Nah.
Okay, see, here's the thing. People confuse what we consider underground music or real music and feel like you can't sell that.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's true.
And there's a huge difference. I think if people would take the time to really refine their show, number one, too many times when you go to underground hip-hop shows, it's 10 people on stage that have nothing to do with the show. You know, there's no organization. You didn't even rehearse. You're not presenting me with a presentation.
With a product I want to buy.
Yeah, if I go see a play, right, we're in a mental state and we understand that the person on stage is acting. I paid a ticket and I want to see some type of play. You're telling me something, right? If I pay my money and I go see you and all I get is yo, here I got a million freestyles, I can rhyme. It's like, what are you giving me? You know what I mean? Too many. We have very talented MCs, but they do that. They just get on stage and they freestyle forever. And it's like, where's your song? Where's your content? What are you giving to the people? How are you presenting it? What makes this a show? What about you is special that I should give you my $15 or $10 or whatever it is? What about you is going to make a movement? What about you is going to have my kids going, yo, I really like this guy. He's special to me, right? They don't take enough time to think about those type of things. So then they want to criticize and go, oh, well, you know, they sell all these records because they're this. No, we work hard. Like, we sit there and make records and we critique and we go, yo, okay, is that really what we need to put out right now?
Okay.
How many people is going like this? Okay, well, I know that this record, this DOA record is going to satisfy Guru and all his friends in the barbershop. You understand what I'm saying? But
okay,
girls may not like that record, right? So we're going to make this record that the girls is going to like, and I'm a just tolerate it because it's not corny. As long as the girl record ain't corny, I'm cool with it. You know what I'm saying? Then we come across a New York State of Mind and be like, okay, everybody going to like this. Let's put this, you know what I'm saying? But then it's strategic. So the first thing you always get is the record to satisfy the me's, right? You're
the
always
going
to get this street record. If you notice that, it may not be the first single,
yeah,
but it's always the first thing you hear is for the street, because that's where the buzz come from,
yeah,
right? Then we're going to give you something that's going to live on radio, right, and be this super huge record. Not that no one can predict that New York would become the biggest,
that
big of a record. You never know that. But you get the feeling like, okay, we got one. You know what I mean? My only concern with that record was,
which one? The New York State of Mind?
New York State of Mind. When we got it, it was sort of like, are we alienating people that live outside of New York City?
Okay.
That was my only question. Like,
I
knew how good the record was.
Yeah. Oops. Well, actually, we'll listen to DOA first.
La da da da. Hey.
Rapper to rewrite history without a pen, no ID on the track, let the story begin. This is anti-auto-tune, death of the ringtone. This ain't for iTunes, this ain't for sing-alongs. This is Sinatra at the opera, bring a blonde, preferably with a fat ass who can sing a song. Wrong, this ain't politically correct, this might offend my political connects. My raps don't have melodies. This should make jackets want to go and commit felonies. Get your chain took in. I may do it myself, I'm so Brooklyn. I know we facing a recession, but the music y'all making gon' make it the Great Depression.
So that record came from you.
It came from a conversation that we had in Hawaii about, like, where music was at. It was whack and we need to change it.
With Kanye West.
Yeah. In that room was me, Kanye, Jay, Timbaland. you know, we was just all down there making music, but that was sort of the conversation.
So how do you explain that in 808 and Heartbreak?
Because Kanye's not Jay.
True.
You understand what I'm saying? Every person is allowed to have their own expression. You know what I mean? It's when everybody does it.
Yes.
Right? And to be honest with you, Ye was probably the main person, like, yo, Jay, you need to...
You to be make that record.
Yeah, yeah. That was like... You got to be truthful and honest. When people just jump on something and it gets to the point where it's so watered down, it just sounds nasty. And it actually hurts the culture. It hurts the music.
But when that record dropped, I remember everybody was like, yes, finally, thank you, hallelujah. Jay finally said, okay, that's enough. But you as an engineer, what did you think about auto-tune as a tool? Or
I don't like auto-tune, now to explain to people that are not really technical people, the reason auto-tune was created was not for the T-Pain effect, right? That's just an effect that came about because T-Pain figured out, okay, if I slide this all the way over and I do this, I get this little computery sounding effect. It's cool. It was really made so that, like, a lot of times you'll get singers in and they'll sing something and it'll have so much emotion in it and it'll be perfect. It'll be the take that you want, but maybe one or two notes went off, right? So it was a tool that you could use and say, this is the key of the song. You run the person's voice through it and it'll correct the off notes, right? Me, myself, as an engineer, I don't like to use a tool to correct the off notes. I'm going to ask the singer to sing it again. You understand what I'm saying? There's very rare times, but if the performance is that great and they do an off note, I'm keeping the take. It has the feel in it. Mary J. Blige has some off notes, but the feel is you cannot duplicate the feel of what she did. So why worry about the couple little off notes? You know what I mean? But me personally, I would go, excuse me, on such and such and such and such a word, you were off. You need to sing that a little bit lower. Or I just tell the singer you were sharp or you were flat. You know, I will instruct the singer to do it again versus having a computer do it. Now, when we get into the age of non-singing singers, then I'd rather just you go ahead and sing. Let me get you out the studio and then I'm going to fix the record for what the company wants, because you shouldn't be singing in the first place. You know what I'm saying? But this is a person that has, like, you know, a TV show and this other thing. Then they go, oh, let's make a record.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I don't like using auto-tune, but I've used it. You know what I mean? Or there are times when I do like the effect. A lot of reggae music has auto-tune in it, and sometimes I like it in reggae music. You know what I'm saying? So it just depends on what it is. But anything that's overused gets corny.
Okay.
So it's like now. Like, Lex Luger comes out with a certain style of beat, and it wins, so then every producer sounds like Lex Luger, and I'm like, you'll never win copying him. You know what I mean? You got to be the next whatever it is. You got to be him and not copy him.
Can you explain to us why you were not that involved in Watch the Throne, and do you think you're...
Just because it was okay, everybody has their way of working, so Kanye got his whole
team, Hawaii situation.
He got his whole team with him, right? Then Jay, we have a whole team. So it's you don't walk in and just try to bully a situation or say, let me mess up this flow, because it's not like I'm going to be with Ye every day. You know what I'm saying? So as he's flying around the world, he needs the guys that's going to be with him every day. Noah is with him every day. Mike Dean is with him. You know what I'm saying? These are the guys that are Kanye's team, that help Kanye produce and do all the things that he does. Dion, you know what I'm saying? No ID. So it's like, I got to actually sit back and just watch the actual album being created, you know what I mean? Or like listen to songs halfway done, you know what I mean? And to me, it was like, okay, this is dope that I don't have to really do the work and I can still just make comments about what was going on.
So do you think that your involvement or your lack thereof is a reason why Watch the Throne is more of a Kanye album that's heavily features Jay-Z?
I think it's even. I think if you look at, I think you can you might lean it towards Kanye for your opinion because of the production, because Jay doesn't produce. You know what I'm saying? But if you think about ideas and raps and all that other stuff, it's pretty much, to me, it's even. You know what I'm saying? I think they do a great job of piggybacking off of each other on that album. And I also think when you really get to the depth of it, it is probably the most socially conscious pop album that we've had in a very long time. There are no songs like No Church in the Wild. Like, people are scared to make them type of songs, right? So it's like, it's a very socially conscious album when you get to the real core of it. Even when Ye is in his super flossing, you know what I'm saying, state is still, there's a reason for that title, you know what I'm saying? There's a reason why, like, niggas in Paris is a huge idea, because we're not really supposed to be here.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to be dead. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah.
That's why Jay said, if you've been through all the shit that I've been through, you being Paris getting fucked up too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's a celebration. Like, tonight, we've been waiting for this night for a very long time.
Niggas in Paris. In Paris. Yeah.
And for the first night,
I made it, like, in a braggadocious, I got more money. It's a thank God I made it. It's a, yo, I'm not really supposed to have made it.
That shit crack. That shit crack.
Walked on so hard, motherfuckers wanna find me.
That shit crack. That shit crack. That shit crack.